ladies and gent. Wow, this one's quite loud.
Fantastic. Okay. Hello, hello.
Hi.
Hi, everyone.
Meet our friend Fred. He's going to be hanging out with us today, just chilling. He may pitch. If he pitches, we should all walk away and leave.
He doesn't get any votes, though.
Right, no votes. So again, my name is Christian Ross.
I am Kristen Slink, and we are your co-hosts this evening for the 93rd.
This is crazy.
Village. This is 93, you guys.
93.
That's wild.
So who is it their first time today?
Wow.
Okay. Welcome. We're so...
That is a great number.
Yeah, we're so glad to see you.
Yeah.
So just to let you know how this works, first of all, we are sitting right here at Atlanta Tech Village. Atlanta Tech Village is the fourth largest tech hub in the United States, y'all. Yeah. So we got to give it up for Atlanta because
woo-woo!
We weren't here 10 years ago. We weren't on anyone's list, and we've had major exits. You can see on the graduation wall outside when you leave, but Calendly grew up here. Sales Loft grew up here. So many companies that are huge and making an impact in the markets today. So we are going to have four dynamic companies come up and pitch. And tonight is our, what would you call it tonight?
Early stage startup night.
Yes, early stage startup. So these companies just getting their feet wet. They are out here. They may need you as a beta tester. They may have expansive email lists that they are getting ready to launch. So just know it takes a lot of courage to come up here on the stage and to get in front of people. So for some reason, someone pauses or does whatever, let's clap it out. Let's clap it out, cheer them on, let them know that we are here. So each company has 5 minutes to pitch, and then you will have 5 minutes for questions. So your questions are going to make them stronger entrepreneurs. So ask them anything. Ask them, how are you going to be profitable? When are you going to ask them whatever you want? That is your time.
This is the opportunity for the founders to get feedback. So the more questions you ask, the better in tuned they will be to be able to get their pitches ready and not have any questions, right? So please be thoughtful with that. Raise your hand if you do have a question. They'll repeat it, answer it, and we'll continue until the timer goes.
So I don't have any swag in my hands, okay? Let's just put that out there now. But I am going to have a giveaway! Woo! And you'll get it later. Don't worry.
Who get a receipt.
Who came from the farthest place? I have an idea. I have an idea who
may
win.
It's a trick question.
It's not.
You know.
Who came from the farthest place?
Where did you guys come from? Jonesboro.
Jonesboro.
Los Angeles.
Los Angeles.
Oh, no, where? Buford.
Buckhead. You know what?
I think California is a little further than Buckhead, but I don't know.
I talked to these fabulous people right here, and they told me they are from...
Pakistan.
All right.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I think Pakistan wins.
Japan.
Okay, we have Pakistan, Japan. Okay, we're going to make sure we get two shirts for you guys, okay? Don't worry. We'll have two shirts. First up.
All right. I am very excited to introduce Rhiannon Vaughn of Cibola Story, and she will take it over.
Let's give it up.
Thank you. Okay. When I first got to Hollywood, I was feeling pretty confident. I had already invested a lot of time and a lot of money in screenwriting courses and a graduate degree. My work was getting recognized. And I even quit my day job, which was actually a pretty solid career in business banking, if I do say so myself. When I finally got the chance to sit down with someone who was interested in my work, I was so excited. I had this script I was really passionate about. I spent a lot of time, and I really wanted to share. And he stopped me right away and was like, no, thanks. Just send me a treatment. Now, my first response was probably pretty similar to a lot of you today, was, what's a treatment? I had just dedicated years of my life learning the very specific craft of screenwriting, and I had never heard of a treatment before. And I'm not alone in this. This is insider information. So I am going to let you in on a little Hollywood secret. Nobody wants to read your screenplay. And I get it. Essentially, I was running around asking strangers to read over 100 pages. And that's 100 pages of subtle clues and subtext that slowly build into the third act. It's not an easy read. But a treatment, that is easy. A treatment is a pitch and a synopsis and everything that you need to know about a story in just a few pages. And honestly, here's the reality. Of the tens of thousands of scripts that are written each year, only about 25 are ever actually sold. And there are hundreds of projects sold each year, and the rest of those are sold as a treatment. And it makes sense. With a treatment, investors can see very quickly whether or not a story is good, and that time is key because they're getting thousands of scripts a year. And so as a writer, being able to write a compelling treatment is crucial. So enter Cibola Story Studio. We help writers write better stories in a format that'll actually be read. Cibola Story Studio is project management software where screenwriters can develop their ideas in treatment format, whether they realize it or not. It takes all of the strategic planning that goes into a story and keeps it in one treatment dashboard. Now, this platform was built out of my own personal need as a busy mom trying to write, and my co-founder's need as a brilliant screenwriter who just gets really blocked when it comes to writing a treatment. We built this platform with care and intention and feedback from many writers about their process. And we were able to successfully launch an MVP last year. We already have several highly influential Reed Emmy-nominated writers on the platform, but this is just the first step of the greater vision. Right now, we're working really hard to build what is essentially a sales force for production companies, with that treatment dashboard being a bridge for collaboration between writers and development executives, quite literally getting them on the same page. We're hoping to solve the problem of development hell. There are competitors out there, but we exist at a very specific nexus point between writers and producers, focusing on the very specific role a treatment plays in getting shit made. And with my background in business and tech and my co-founder's deep-rooted relationships across TV and film, we feel uniquely poised to capitalize on this opportunity, especially since we've moved to Atlanta. We feel like we're at exactly the right place at exactly the right time. And it really is. There are more writers getting paid than ever before. And the streaming wars have created an insatiable demand for original scripted content. Companies are investing billions of dollars each year, and we want to help protect this investment from the very beginning. So, if you or someone you know is an angel investor, we'd love to connect and get to know you. This QR code is me. I am Rhiannon Vaughn, and I thank you so much for your time. And now I will take any questions.
Does anyone have any questions? All right, I see a few in the back.
Do I pick who?
You pick.
Oh, you. Great question. So the platform that, the question is, how do screenwriters protect their property if they put it on the platform for studios? So there are two different platforms. We have Cibola Story Studio, which is for any screenwriter can go out. It is not public, it is private. Only you have access to your ideas. Actually, you can collaborate with co-writers and then you give very specific access. You can also invite people to read your story and then you give an expiration date so they can only read up to a certain date if you want to move on after you get their feedback. And then on the development side, usually you, the writer, would join this platform once you have signed a deal with the production company. So essentially they own the idea that you co-own it and you're developing it together. And so it would only exist in the hands of you guys. And I will say that this is like also a point that leads me to AI. One of the big arguments about AI is making sure that we don't train an AI with your ideas. And so we have committed to staying off of AI platforms until we can find a way to have an in-house private machine learning platform to protect your idea. Great. Congratulations. We do not facilitate the relationship between you and production companies. But what we do is you are a book writer, and you may not have much experience with pitching a story to a production company. So the platform is built in a way that it's templated so that you have the professional format that's expected across the industry. And so it'll give you clues based on the sections of how you put out the information from the book to a script format so that you have the bones that you need, so that you can pitch your idea, so that you can sell this screenplay or sell the rights to your book. It also creates a situation where you may not want to write the script, and so you can sell the treatment and get story by credit and then work with the production company to hire a screenwriter to finish that for you. And so it's creating the template or the format for you to be able to have the freedom to do what you want with your story. Thank you. I didn't repeat the question, did I?
I actually don't know.
Okay. I'm going to go to you.
Sure. So I have a friend who's in film and TV in New York. He wants to know, how does your product help fix bad storylines? Because that's why things wind up in development.
Okay, great question. How does my platform help fix bad storylines? I mean, the big thing is that it puts out all of the information. Let me show you what it looks like. It puts it all out there so you can see it visually laid out. You can see if there's any gaps. Have you thought about your characters? Is there one person with no bio? Maybe you need to go back there. Do you have all of the beats of your story? So it puts it out visually so that you can find any holes. But more than that, there's a collaboration element where you can send your treatment out to readers and collect feedback through forms in the platform. And you can save what's helpful notes and discard what's not helpful notes, because you know, not all notes are good notes. You hopefully can continue to iterate, just like anything, right? You can continue to write it in before you ever get to the script. Yeah, I hope that helps. Thank you. Thank you. Oh my God. Oh yeah, last week. Yes, good eye. Oh, okay, so this is a great question. I'm just gonna repeat the first part where he said it was brilliant. and then he asked if there's a way to crowdsource stories through the platform. This is it because we're out of time. And I will say that this platform is not for that. It is not public facing. We're not necessarily competing with the Blacklist, which is, or Play, what is it, the new play exchange is, as a playwright, that's where I put my work, right, for people to source it. So this is not public, but I think on the development studio side, one of the goals is once we have clients who are production companies, management companies, and agencies. We want to be able to give data about who are their writers. You say you value diversity. Are your writers diverse? You say that you want to tell this story, or what is the story of your production company? We want to be able to speak to that. And so I think ultimately, once we get to that place, that sounds like a great idea of creating a peer-to-peer producer network, like being able to self-produce and really develop an indie scene, because we're all about that. I'm so sorry, we are out of time.
Let's give it up for Zibala Story Studio.
Yes.
For the record, I feel like this is the first time we've had a screenwriter, at least that told us they were a screenwriter, in the crowd. So that's pretty cool.
Well, we were actually talking about it earlier, and so a good thing about this event is that there's a lot of general, like the audience is pretty general, right? And so a lot of times you're just speaking out there, but she had a couple of potential customers in here, which is amazing.
I
love that. Awesome.
So who here recycles? Raise your hand. All right. To the rest of you. I'm joking. We don't recycle shame around these parts. We don't do that. But very excited because we have Mr. Jana Subramani, who is about to talk to us about turning green.
All
it's right. On you, sir.
Give it up. You turn green.
Thank you. I know we are going to go from storyboard to saving the planet, so your left to right brain should work now. So basically, welcome all, and thanks for being here tonight. I'm super excited to talk to you about our mobile app that we built to for individual consumers to go green. So basically, if any of you are here, employers or corporates or organizations, I'm sure you know they're all starting the sustainability officers and so on. So, but have you ever thought about taking your employees on your green journey? I know you're going and doing your ESG stuff, or sustainable supply chain and logistics. But have you ever thought about taking your own employees? If not, then that's where we are here. So our app helps to take your employees onto the green journey. But there is a problem. And the problem is, no matter how hard we tried and went and spoke to B2C consumers, it's very hard for us to make them sign up to the app. So we went ahead and found out, like, why is this happening? Why are they not signing up for our app? And basically, we found that there is no recognition for the individuals per se, and no benefits for them, you know. And of course, there is no common place for them to go do any of those green tasks. So why would anybody want to do a green task to save the planet when they're busy doing their own life, right? Like saving their own life. You know, they're running to have their life by themselves. So we then adapted all of these, feedback, and then we went back. And so we came up with this app. We went back to them asking, can you do it now? But still we failed miserably, because that's still an option for them, right? Nobody is forcing them. Nobody is putting a gun to them right now. So the solution, I think what we see is the employers. Only the employers can make the employees, you know, help the employees do the green task. Again, it doesn't have to be hard say, but they just have to probably, you know, add a paid day off to go ahead and do a sustainable activity, right? So that way they take a day off and then they go and do some useful green tasks. And also we have plans to introduce green scoreboard in the company. So that way, you know, we can show them what are the top 10 employees who by score, who are the top green task doers. And that would motivate the other employees. Of course, then the employer can still, give more incentive to the employees in many other ways. But these are the two things that we can think about. So how does this work? So when you, as an employee, do a task in our platform, which is a mobile app, you are given points, and then the points are converted into dollars. So as an employer, you can buy your own employees points. So that's almost like the employer is going to harvest their own employees' green efforts. So it's like kind of a dual benefit, you know. So they kind of got all the green efforts from their employees. So, and how do we use this money? We use this money to do more green tasks. So basically, I'll show you a couple of examples of what the green tasks are, but we introduce green, one task is saving electricity is one green task. And there's another company called Mill. I don't know how many of you heard about this. This company actually is a food waste avoiding company. So they came up with a trash can style product that, you know, they burn all the food items in the night, and then they convert all your food waste into like dry particles, and that you can ship it. So we are going to work with them and introduce another green task in our platform. So there is no limit to how many tasks we can basically add to our platform. So here is how we do it. So we have all the employees here doing the green task, and then they gain all the points. And then as an employer, all the way up here, you can buy those points. But as an individual consumer who doesn't care, but you know, let's say they have a, you know, they're rich and they don't have time to do you know, the green silly things. If they think that way, they can subscribe to us, or they can buy these points directly. So we need to categorize and put people in multiple demographics. I know it's not for everybody, but then that's another option. So here are the four areas where we are going to introduce the tasks: energy, plastics, water, and environment. And here is a final scorecard that we would actually give for each employee of your company. You would get a scorecard like this. And since we have the data, we can produce like analytics and reporting at a very at the employer level and also at the employee level. So right now, this is the market. We are in a mobile app platform, but we can always convert that into a SaaS platform. All we are looking for is employers to onboard with us, like with less than $20,000. That means you're probably helping 1,000 to 2,000 people to onboard into our platform, and probably, or you are helping to avoid like 100,000 pounds of CO2 from getting emitted into the atmosphere. So there is so much that this $20,000 can do, and imagine a lot of employers coming on board and making their employees bring, you know, take the employees on board. That's like unbelievable change that we can do to this planet. So we do have options for investors.
The timer has gone off, unfortunately.
And thank you. And here is where you can reach us, and open for any questions now. Thank you.
Questions for you, Turn Green.
For the employers, or? Right. So the question is, what is the pain point for the employer to sign up to our platform, right? Actually, we just launched our app like a few months ago, and this is my first pitch ever. So, and we are on the journey. So it's just that we need to connect with the employer and make sure that we explain them, hey, you know, there's a platform, and this is like a platform like Amazon, right? It can expand. It's just today you can have two tasks, but it is one place where you can come and do anything you want. So I think it's probably the time, and you know, in a few more months, or we should be able to gain the employers. That's our confidence. Yeah. Thank you. That's a good question. So the question is, can the person doing the green task, can they pick and choose, or can the task be customized? Did I get that right? It's certainly doable, but this is an MVP. So at the moment, like what is available is like the task that we introduce. So either it is an organic task that we introduced, or we partner with the business like Mill, and Sense is another company. So right now we don't have the flexibility for the employer to customize it based on the passion. But those are the four areas we're going to focus: the water, electricity, energy, water, plastics, and environment. Those are the four areas that we need to attack first. It's not about the passion. It's not like, you know, it's not a hobby that we are trying to solve. We are trying to solve real problems based on those four domains. So there is not much customization, except if you want to add more tests to a particular domain, you can. We can always add it. I hope that answers your question. Fantastic question. So that's what I said. Like, I'm not sure if you heard about ESG. The question is, again, can you please repeat? I forgot it already. Sorry. I'm in the answer part. Sorry. I'm still not getting your question. I'm so sorry. Okay. Yeah, I think I got it now. So, yeah, I got the question. The question is, why would the employer basically trust what we are doing, rather than like their own goals, right? So yeah, so the number one I think the employers are doing is, like I told you, like supply chain. They're like trying to make it sustainable, more sustainable, and so many other things. They're basically part of a program called ESG, Environment Social Governance. And I'm not sure, I don't want to get into those BlackRock and ESG stuff. So it is a program where employers are certified. You are this, you are that. So would you consider that Tesla is a company, is an EV maker? Do you think Tesla's ESG score would be higher than Shell's? What do you think? It's not. So that's the case. That's where we are at. So it is not working. It is working only, I mean, again, you know, it could stir up a lot of conversations, but let's not go in there. But that's where the world is headed. So that's why what we are trying to do is at least the part where the individual actions matter, that's what we want to do. We want at least take the employers, individuals, because I see a lot of individuals who are very interested in doing, they want to do it, but they don't have a platform to do it. But we are doing it, we are incentivizing them to do it. It's not like we are not going to pay you like half biweekly pay, but it's good enough to keep that motivation up and running. You know, it's not for you, it's for younger generations. It's a lot of things are happening around the world. On top of that, yes, the wars, I mean, even if you start doing it, the war and other stuff is going to bring, you know, one bomb like would take like 100,000 people's energy for a month. So
let's give it up for you. Thank you. Turn green.
Great job. That was his first pitch, everyone. So we're just gonna get the next pitch ready here. Good questions so far, everyone. Keep them coming.
All right. real quick.
Come on, show everyone.
We need to make sure YouTube sees you. The people at home need to see
come
you.
Come on up.
Yes. Get it all together.
We've
yes,
got our
yes,
festive
yes.
friend over here.
Where's my phone? We need a selfie.
Yeah. All right. So we chatted earlier today and learned that this entire costume is custom. Yeah.
Look at this.
All of it.
All custom, everything. What?
Hey, I'm James King.
James King here.
You look fabulous. Let's give it up for James King, y'all. Hold on, take a selfie with him. James,
hey, selfie.
Sorry.
All right, so our next pitch is Maximus Mercer with Ava.
The
All
magic
right,
with
put it
Let's
together.
Go.
What's up, everybody? My name is Maximus Mercer, and I'm the founder and CEO of Ava. And we are creating the next generation of mobile devices. The smartphone era is over. Since the birth of the smartphone back in 07, we have been promised the world of opportunity, endless possibilities, and immense amount of features. But sadly, that dream has come to an end. Phone companies of today, like Apple, Google, Samsung, have all been giving us the same basic, bland, and boring experience. Lack of features, lack of design, lack of everything that we need to truly enhance our lives with these technologies. And like all things, it must come to an end. Okay. Ava believes in a future that has XR, AI, and gamification included inside of it. Extended reality, AI, artificial intelligence, and gamification, gamifying your life to the maximum. Extended reality has the potential to truly revolutionize our world forever, giving us the ability to really enhance our ability to connect with life on a scale much bigger than ever. XR has the potential, has the growth potential of 33.9% at a CAGR rate. From 2021 to 2030, it has been growing at a CAGR rate, that's what I meant to say, at 33.9%. AI, the next revolution of life. AI has an immense amount of potential, and we've already been seeing it in this era alone. AI has been growing mass amounts of potential. It has a CAGR rate of 19.1%. From today and this year all the way to 2032, has potential to reach up to $594 billion. And honestly, the way Ava wants to take it, we'll take it up to $1 trillion. Gamification. Now, I personally think this is a very underrated sector of life, honestly. Gamifying your life. Being able to turn your life, every aspect of your life, into a video game. Every aspect that you do, when you're running, going out, working out. When you're working out, it is an entire video game as you are working out at the same time. Same thing with your productivity. As you're working on anything that you do, it is a game. Life should be fun in our eyes, and this is what we want to bring. Gamification has potential to reach up to $116 billion from being at $10 billion just by the end of 2032. A lot of potential right there. And I want to introduce you to the device that we are going to change the world with, the Ava Dream. Ava meaning life in Latin. Dream, you know, meaning fantasy world. And we bring these two words together to replicate a fantasy life that you can create for yourself with a dream. An entire universe of imagination in the palm of your hand. We bring a different design, we bring a whole different experience. Phones right now are real boxy, bland, boring, like I stated earlier in the intro. But Ava brings a new revolutionary design to phones. We bring a more rounded, archway-like design to our device. Almost indicating, not even almost, really representing a portal as if you're entering an entirely new dimension. Because when you're looking into your phones, ladies and gentlemen, that is an entirely new dimension right there in the palm of your hands. And this is what we are trying to replicate. A new dawn, like the one you've seen on maybe Lion King or something at the beginning. Hardware features, we have a whole plethora of hardware features that I really want to get into, but since I only have 5 minutes and I'm really counting down, I got to get to my ask. We have so many hardware features, up to 13 colorways to choose from. I'm tired of the 4 or 5 bland-looking colors. We have 13 design colors. On top of that, we offer up to from 5.5 inches to choose from your phone all the way up to 6.8 inches. No more just 2 design inches. On top of that, we have USB-C, you know, because of Europe, you know. On top of that, we utilize XR features to enhance our phone's experience. I got to skip, unfortunately. Here's some of the more hardware features. This is a drawing I made in my room. These are XR displays that I like to call just dream displays on your phone as you're using them. Here's a demo on Blender. Oh, wow. Okay. Imagine Software. This is the new OS system that we are going to be using in the future. Imagine is the future. No more of the bubble boxes and widgets. We are bringing a whole new virtual world inside your phone right then and there. I'm gonna get to my ass because that's what I made this for. These are some more pictures I drew. I want this thing to come true. The dream settings right there. The dream world ideas that I got that I'm floating around. Dang, come on now. All right, this is our ask. We're looking for $550,000 to $600,000 in pre-seed rounds. This is our first round ever. A team of 8, including myself, so it would be 7 without me. We're looking for a 3D artist to really refine this design. This is not the end design I want to make, but since this just gives you something to show, I need a software team to give you a software sample of what I'm trying to make. A creative artist to help me draw this out. A web developer, help us make a website for this. And creative equipment like Blender Assets, Adobe Creative Cloud, Maxon, and the 3D printer. And preferably, I would really like an office space here in Atlanta Tech Village for you guys, you know what I'm saying? But and a design patent. The biggest one of all, and I put it last, unfortunately, but a design patent of $25,000. This is my contact, and oh, this is the vision. It don't just begin, it don't just end with the phone and the device. There's so much more that we want to do. This is a concept of the computer I want to make called the Dreambook, DreamPad, DreamPods, everything. We're going to take it to a whole new level. And it don't just start with devices, appliances, smart homes, everything in your life. We're going to transform all that. We're going to take it, really. Here's where you can contact me at. Instagram, Facebook, LinkedIn, email. Y'all can hit me up anytime.
Who has questions for Mr. Maximus?
What's that name? Oh, wow. Okay, so the question was, how did I come up with such an ingenious idea? Wow. And the humblest of ways, this all came from just in my room. I was sitting in my room. I've always had a dream and a passion for technology. And ironically, I major in political science. This is way left field, so this is something different. But this is a personal passion of mine. Political science was as well, but this is more a personal passion. I was just sitting in my room one time, and it really, all this was really an app. It was an all-in-one app called iLife, unfortunately. Apple already had that long time ago, and I had to diverge myself from that name. And Ava was an AI system that I created when I was 17 years old. But I was sitting in my room, I was like, why aren't phones in the shapes of ovals? And ironically enough, I was looking at an airplane window. An airplane window, you know, is round. Some of them are square, but the one I was looking at preferably was round. And I was looking at it, and I was like, man, why aren't phones like that? And so the phone journey began. It started, it had hips. It had everything. I like to call them hips. It was just round. It was like a circle. You know what I'm saying? It had hips on it. And then eventually, I just slimmed it down. I really started tweaking it with my, you know, with the design mind I got, I guess. And the Ava dream was born. But good question, man. Appreciate it. What's happening? So the question was, have I thought about selling advertisements on my platform for businesses? For sure, that would be definitely a feature that we would definitely consider in the future. I really haven't really had a business mind to think about with this. It was more all just like creative fun, just having a good time with making it. But for sure, that is something that we definitely want to add into this. Yes, ma'am. A prototype? At the moment, this is just a 3D. I actually have a prototype in my phone in my book bag. I forgot to bring it up. It's a 3D printed, but it's horrible. All right. Yes, sir. So the question was, do I see myself as the Web 3.0 era? Yeah. I know a lot about the decentralized kind of Web 3.0 era, stuff like that, Web 4.0, 5.0, you know, as far as it goes. But I don't really like to consider myself in that era. I like to consider myself somebody who admires creativity, somebody who really wants a phone or a device to truly represent you for who you are. I don't really know about the whole decentralization. I feel like that's just a cue to get away from whatever the government got going on, but that's a whole nother sector. I ain't even got to go into that. What's happening? So, right here, the device I just showed you is what we call a hyperphone. Oh, what's the question? Say it again real quick. How does it replace the smartphone? Okay, so the question was, the question was, how does this device replace a smartphone? And this device replaces a smartphone in so many different ways. What I like to call this device is more of a hyperphone. This is the next generation of a smartphone. The smartphone era is dead. You can't really push it too much more. Smartphone is really just the culmination of a cell phone and a computer combined in one. What this does is combine VR or XR in my case, AI and gamification alongside the cell phone and computer capabilities to create this new hyper experience. So for instance, I could talk about the messaging software, which I really wanted to post on here, but I ain't had that much time. I really ran up 15 seconds going through 4 slides. But we have a messaging system where it's more immersive. So instead of just seeing two bubbles connect and communicate with one another, we take it to a whole nother level. It's like a gamified system. It's almost like you're communicating with avatars. So in the phone, you'll be looking at your phone in the messaging. I'm trying to describe it the best way possible, but you will have an avatar and your friend will have an avatar and you can create your own virtual world within that messaging system, within that messaging world, I should say. So your friend, that'll be his little environment and you and him will be interacting. And as you interact, you can see your avatars interacting at the same time. So instead of it just being two bubbles and text boxes all the way down the thing, you got two avatars. And on top of that, now you have so many more features. You can swipe up, it's like a bubble. Oh man, I really wish I could have showed y'all, but it's like a bubble and you can really see the environment around. Y'all can play games and it's like this seamless system that goes in and everything like that. But and on top of that, I forgot to even mention the dream screen, the big bubble you saw on the back of that phone. What I showed you was the back of the phone. It's a big bubble on the back of the phone. That's the dream screen or the dream lens. And that right there is the next generation of where I see cameras going. I wish I could have answered some of y'all, man. I saw y'all. My bad.
Time is up.
I can't
time
answer
time is it. Up.
Ah, dang.
Thank you, Maximus.
You got it.
All right. Great job. All right. We're going to get our last pitch up here. So does anyone here like to travel? Show of hands, travel. Okay. This one's for you.
This one's for you. Does anyone have any plans for Halloween tomorrow? Work?
Mm-hmm.
I just want to say it's my birthday this week. Woo!
Happy birthday. What day?
It's the first.
What day is it?
November 1st.
Wednesday?
Yeah, Wednesday.
What's today? Monday.
Today's Monday.
Yeah.
It is. That's right. Scorpio's in the house. Did it go a little smaller?
Oh, there we go.
There we go. All right. Let's give it up for Travel Hotline.
Yay. Ow, ow!
Okay. Hey, everyone. My name is Nilo. I'm the founder of Travel Hotline, and I love to travel. How many of you in here like to travel? Okay. Now, how many of you in here enjoys planning travel? Right. Okay. Not so many hands. That's exactly why our mission is to rebrand the travel planning process into a fast, easy, and stress-free experience for all, because we recognize that, this is not working. It's not working. Mm-mm, neither one.
Your computer?
I don't know. Technical difficulties.
There you go.
so I know we gonna be here a while. In the bathroom, flat out.
Please bear with us. Technical difficulties.
In the mall, steady racking up the air miles. Hit the gym, step on the scale, stay at the number. Say you dropping 10 pounds, preparing for summer. And you don't do it for the man, man never notice. You just do it for yourself, you the coldest. Intelligent too, ooh, you my sweetheart. I've always liked my women book and street smart. Long as they got it.
Well, we all know technology is great when it works. Crazy when it doesn't. Sorry.
I almost fell.
There we go. Look at that.
Just needed the power of Nisha.
All right. There we go.
All right. Bring it back together.
Okay. So I'll just jump right back in. So we recognize that just over 200 million people prefer to plan and book their travel online, but half of them hate this process. The average traveler has to navigate between 38 different platforms and do over a week of research just to book a vacation. But what if a singular app could plan and book the perfect trip in under 5 minutes? Would you download it? Travel Hotline is pioneering the travel evolution by seamlessly combining artificial intelligence with psychology and the user's unique preferences to plan and book the perfect vacation in under 5 minutes. Oh, this was kind of slow. Okay, so we start with an efficient intake process that leverages social and personality psychology. And your answers are super important in this process because we'll use them to make suggestions that align perfectly with your desires. We'll employ artificial intelligence to sift through vast amounts of data to handpick not generic, but TikTok-worthy recommendations that are as unique as you are. So I'd like to take you guys through the user flow of what it looks like when a traveler wants to book a trip and they come on Travel Hotline. So whether you're a busy business traveler, a budget-conscious traveler, the mom or the dad that plans the family trips, or the friend that plans the group trips, Travel Hotline can plan a trip for any occasion. So we start off by giving this trip a name. Select your dates, as usual. Select your budget. So our AI model will not surpass the budget that you select on this screen. What if you don't know where you want to go, but you do know you don't like to travel abroad? We wouldn't even recommend Europe or Asia. We'd recommend some hot destinations in the USA or even some island vibes if you're feeling up to it. Our AI model also considers what kind of trip it is. So depending upon that, we'll also make suggestions specific to the occasion. Travel Hotline is group trip friendly. Users will be able to collaborate on itineraries directly within the app. They'll be able to split payments. They will be able to book elements at different time periods. So if you want to book your flights now, excursions later, you'll have the flexibility to do that. And the trip owner will be able to determine whether you can view, edit, or comment on the itinerary. I'm sure all of you have had to enter in your information for flights, cars, hotels, excursion after excursion after excursion several times, but Travel Hotline will always prompt you to check over your information, and then at the end of this entire process, we'll book all of your reservations for you at one time. Now, if you're anything like me and you like to travel early in the morning, nonstop, and only with Delta, then you would only see flights that's specific to that criteria here. In addition to what add-ons come with that flight, what add-ons come with which flight, and how much it costs. We'll also be showcasing cars, stays, excursions, but also restaurants. So I don't like to eat breakfast on every time that I travel. Maybe you're the same way. You'll also be able to select different categories of cuisine, and then our AI model will, I'm sure you guys guessed it, make recommendations accordingly. And now we're building your dream travel experience. This is a very basic version directly from our prototype of what an itinerary is gonna look like. So essentially the idea is time on the left, activity on the right, you're able to edit it. I'm gonna rush because I'm running out of time. Okay, you'll be able to see all of the itineraries in one localized region, whether they're past, present, future, or just saved. It's a 1.5% transaction fee in addition to a 12 to 15% commission fee for the travel institutions, and we'll also be showcasing advertisements. We've been able to probably finally can announce that we have 10,000 users signed up on our wait list, eagerly awaiting our app's launch. Thank you. Yes. Okay, yes, thank you. And while the market is ridiculously huge, we have to start somewhere. Budget-conscious travelers don't have a ton of time, they don't have the expertise to curate the finest travel experience, and they definitely don't have the budget to pay a travel agent to do it. So that's why we've honed in on 16,000 individuals in Atlanta who are primed and ready to reap the rewards of Travel Hotline. To make everyone's travel planning dreams a reality, we need capital. This capital is gonna get us to our first 5,000 paying customers, and we are expected to be profitable in our first year of operation. In addition to fundraising, we are also crowdfunding. So if you're interested in donating to our crowdfunding campaign, feel free to scan this QR code right here. My contact information is listed there. You can also find it at the QR code. Thank you guys for listening to What the Future of Travel Looks Like to me.
Awesome. Now let's open up for some questions.
Yep. Yeah, so we're actually still considered
an question.
Oh, what was the question? Yeah, so real-time prices. How are we going to make sure that we have real-time prices and things like that on our platform? So yeah, we are considered a regular OTA. So when you go on Booking or Expedia, we're pretty much the same thing. So we'll have, initially we're going to use third-party APIs. However, as we get more traction in the marketplace, we're expected to list the travel institutions directly on our platform. Yeah. Yeah, so to my knowledge...
Repeat the question.
How are we going to partner with credit cards where you can get points for booking with them, right? Okay, so to my knowledge, you get points for booking with the credit card, not necessarily for booking in the platform. So it's actually part of my 10-year plan to partner with those companies. And let's say, for instance, you have a Delta, you have a ton of points on Delta. I'm one of them. We're going to partner with them so you can still get your points as long as you're using, like, American Express, for instance. So on and so forth. They're not like our direct competitor. Yeah.
So I have a two-part question. So the first one is, will you guys also be able to accept all of the frequent flyer profiles from all the airlines, hotels, yada, yada, yada? And the second part to that question is, that is a lot of personal data. So what is your data security strategy?
Yeah, so I don't have a data security strategy. What is our data security strategy to hold basically all of the data? Because it's going to be a ton of data. I feel like there's a ton of data everywhere. I'm a non-technical founder. However, of course, I'm going to employ, I would say, that's how true it is. But yeah. So I'm a non-technical founder. I couldn't give you updated information about the date, how we're going to, do our cybersecurity. However, I'm going to employ somebody else to do it. Because,
I would just say I'm going to comply with all of the standards for data security.
Yeah, well, I do know it's what we're trying to do is 100% doable. The security portion is doable as well. It's not, yeah. Yeah. How are we going to handle cancellation? Yeah, absolutely. So the question was, how are we going to handle cancellations? And I would say the same way that any other OTA would. If you cancel, then we'd refund you your money if it's within the limits. But also, Travel Hotline offers a promise that we will never give you a problem without offering three solutions. So yeah, we give you three different type of solutions, whether it's to do something else or an alternative option for you, but we're never going to leave you by yourself while you travel. Yeah. Yeah. So his question was pretty much a follow-up. How would we be able to service, more specifically, delays and cancellations for flights and airlines, right? Okay. So similar process. We'd make sure to notify the consumer, but also we're going to offer three solutions. A lot of people don't always know that the airlines are supposed to pay you X amount of money and get you accommodations for the night. If the airline has that policy in place, we'll be sure to educate our consumer. And if there are any other options that we'd be able to offer them, then we'll do so in our three solution promise. Yeah. Well, honestly, we're gonna launch our MVP. It's gonna be kind of buggy, but what kind of user experience can the users on our waitlist expect on launch? I imagine it's probably going to be a ton of bugs, but we'll still be able to accomplish our mission, which is to plan and book the perfect trip. They'll still be able to go through our intake process. They'll be able to go through the build-a-trip process, and they'll be able to book their travel. And they'll have a much more seamless experience even still.
All right. Let's give it up for our final pitch. Great job. Did everyone catch Fred?
Fred Gangstalined over here. But one thing we didn't tell you was that at the end, you guys get to vote. And whoever wins this evening goes on to the pitch-off. And in the pitch-off, they are able to win 1 year of a hot desk here and parking, which is a $13,000 value.
Yeah. So how it's going to work is Christian's going to put the Slido site up on the screen. And there's a code there to use it. So once it comes up, go and vote for your top pitch tonight. And as she stated, they will go on to the finals. Do we have any music? Grips on your legs, front way, back way. Oh, there it is. You know that I don't right? play. Streets not safe, but I never run away. Even when I'm away. OT, OT, there's never much love when we go OT. I pray to make it back in one piece. I pray. That's why I need a one dance. Got a Hennessy in my hand. Slido.com, code ATLSV93.
ATLSV93 at slido.com. Back to the grooves while you guys choose.
Five, four, three, two, one. Congratulations,
Rhiannon and Vaughn and the Treatments.
Thank you guys all so much for coming up tonight. You have to stand up and take a selfie with us from the stage.
If I can turn this around, there we go. Let's see, you in here? Okay.
One, two, three, smile! Oh, oops, there we go. Video! Thanks for coming, guys!